Good morning and welcome to BC201, course on Christian history and missions. Today we are covering on chapter 8, which talks about the pursuit of revival, the cry for a visitation and move of God. So can I request one of us to turn to Matthew chapter 11, verse 22. Matthew chapter 11, verse 22.
Matthew chapter 11, verse 22. But I tell you, it will be more bearable for Tyre and Sidon on the day of judgment than for you. Matthew chapter 11, verse 12. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has been forcefully advancing, and forceful men lay hold of it.
Mammy, your mic is. Thank you so much. Thank you. So what happens is, in Matthew 11, 12, we see that from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence. The violence taken by force. So suffering is not something new to the kingdom of God, but then it has been there from long back. But what we are talking about here is during the time of revival, during the time of suffering, each individual look up to God and cry out in prayer. The sovereign Lord moves. He works on behalf of us. Revival is something that we cannot manufacture, that no man can manufacture or produce it, but then the Lord moves by himself. So today, as we're going to study how the pursuit of revival or how the visitation of God and the move of God can take place among us when we seek Him. So let's begin the session with a word of prayer. Can I request one of you all to please start the class with a word of prayer? Aradhana, would you like to pray? John, would you like to pray, please?
Sure, let's pray.
Thank you.
Father, we thank you for this time. Lord, we humble ourselves once again as we are going to learn today about pursuit of revival. We pray that you would increase the desire in our heart and help us to focus on your ways, Lord Jesus. We pray that this session would be really helpful for each one of us, and we would be able to apply this in our lives. We submit Pastor into your hand. We pray that you would anoint her with your voice. With your words, Lord Jesus, that we would be able to know the secrets of your heart, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, John. Okay. So as we see that the sovereign work of God and the move of God that no man can do, but then all we can do is prepare a way. So how do we prepare? God always responds to our cry, to a hunger from our heart. So we need to prepare our heart and cry out to the Lord for a revival. This is what in the story in Wesley Duell says. Revivals are the sovereign working of God, but they are always related to the obedience of God's people. I repeat it. Revivals are the sovereign working of God, but they are always related to the obedience of God's people. So what we see is we need to pursue God with persistent heart. We need to have this hunger and burn and passion for God, for more of God. When we seek Him consistently, when we seek Him persistently, you see the Lord Himself moves. The Lord responds to that cry. The Lord responds to that hunger from our heart. We see in Jeremiah 29:11. Can I request one of you all to please read Jeremiah 29:13.
And you will seek me and find me, and when you search for me with all your heart.
Amen. You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. So this is what God is affirming us, that God would not hide from His people when they search for more of Him. They would not suffer under the dark sense that God could not find each of us. So when we seek God, God reveals Himself. This is the hope that God is giving us, that we have seen throughout revival, throughout the history of revival, when we went through, whenever people came together, when they seeked God earnestly through prayer, actually He showed up in a greater glory, isn't it? So it is not that God is holding Himself back, but then He always responds to our hunger, responds to our thirst when we seek God earnestly. So pursuing God, in how we can pursue God? We can pursue God through our prayer, through worship. And we should also understand that Word of God is the key to reviving. So any number of people come together when they seek Him with all their heart, all their mind, and seeking God for a revival. You see, there's a revival being birthed in that place. So it's very simple. When we draw ourselves to God, He draws Himself to us. And this is the promise that He will keep that promise. When you seek me, you will find me. You will not hold back and ask more of Him. Because this is the desire of God Himself, that we seek Him, more of Him in us. We see that in the book of Isaiah, chapter 62, verse 1 to 7. Isaiah 62, verse 1 to 7. It's so important for us to stir ourselves that we may seek God from inside out, earnestly, because our heart attitude is much important for God, because God is a God who does not look at a man at his outward appearance or with his words, but God looks at the condition of our heart. What does our heart attitude say? If any of you all have turned to Isaiah 62, may I request you all to please read verse 1 to 7. Isaiah chapter 62, verse 1 to 7.
Isaiah chapter 62, verse 1 to 7. For Zion's sake, I will not keep silent. For Jerusalem's sake, I will not remain quiet. Till her righteousness shines out like the dawn, her salvation like a blazing torch. The nations will see your righteousness and all kings your glory. You will be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will bestow. You will be a crown of splendor in the Lord's hand, a royal diadem in the hand of your God. No longer will they call you deserted or name your land desolate, but you will be called Hephzibah and your land Beulah, for the Lord will take delight in you and your land will be married. As a young man marries a maiden, so will be your sons marry you. As a bridegroom rejoices over his bride, so will your God rejoice over you. I have posted watchmen on your walls, O Jerusalem. They will never be silent day or night. You who call on the Lord, give yourself no rest and give Him no rest till He establishes Jerusalem and makes her the praise of the earth.
Amen. It's very beautifully the book of Isaiah puts it across. The Zion's sake, I will not hold my peace For Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest until a righteousness goes forth as brightness and a salvation as lamp that burns. Very beautiful. Zion is nothing but God's people. And Jerusalem is the city of God. And here these two are representative of the church in the New Testament, as we see in the scriptures, in the book of Hebrews, and also in the epistle of 1 Peter. So here we see prophet Isaiah is so passionate about the people of God. So we need to understand, you take up any fivefold ministry office, God is calling the people into ministry, is to be passionate for the people. We need to have heart to the people. So here you see the prophet Isaiah is passionate about the people of God. And here he says, though earlier he declared about God's glory in Isaiah 60, and here he is saying he is also aware of the, you know, the forthcoming destruction that's going to come upon the God's people through the captivity of Babylonians. But here, despite of all this, prophet declares that he will contend to see Zion restored. He's promising the people of Israel. He's promising that you belong to God. You are God's people. You are his elect. And God will never give up on you. Despite of your sin, you will stay under captive. But then when you repent, God will release you. God will restore you. God will bring you back to the promised land, Jerusalem. He is declaring that promise over Zion, over God's people, saying that you will be restored back to the city of God. In verse 1, again he says, for Zion's sake, for Jerusalem's sake. Are we passionate about our church? We, the leaders, the church, the God who has called you, God who has raised you as an elect, in each location, in the place where you are that Zion, you are God's people, you are the elect, you are called to that fivefold ministry. Despite which ministry, which office you have been called for, your ministry is to serve people. So despite which office we are called, we need to have the heart and compassion over people. So in that aspect, prophet Isaiah is asking, you know, he's comforting, despite that, you know, God revealed the destruction, the captivity about the people of Israel, but then he's declaring the restoration, that God will restore his people because he loves them. The same way, are we carrying the passionate about our church? Do we want to see our church been restored back to what God desires it to be? Are we looking at each individual as God's child and seeing God's will, God's purpose to be fulfilled in their life? Are we praying about it? Are we discussing with people of God? Are we restoring the plan that God has for them in their life? Is our heart after people? Just like how the heart of God is after people. In verse 1, we also see that I will not keep quiet, I will speak up, I will not rest. Can we take it on ourselves that we will not stop speaking, not to rest till we see the church, the individual, the ministry has been restored to what God wanted it to be, how the church has intended it to be. So what we need to do? Simple. This is what the Lord is asking each of us to do. Get into the presence of God and claim and pray for each individual, for your ministry leaders, for your church, for your ministry to be restored back. Come back to the purpose of the intent, what God intended it to be. So if we don't give up in the process, like how in verse 6 to 7 it says, watchmen, don't keep quiet, don't keep silent, give God no rest. can we get into a time of travailing prayer where we will not give up till we see the church been restored, till we see our prayer has been answered, till you see the individual been transformed. Let us stir others, not just for ourselves. Let's see, look out for the like-minded people who carry the same passion, who has the same heart for people, for ministry, for church. Share it, stir their heart so that we can get along together to pray. So those who will not keep quiet and will pray to the Lord until and unless the prayer has been answered. Because this is the condition of heart that God is expecting each of us to carry when we are praying for revival. Revival will happen when we revive each other. First, we need to revive ourselves and revive each other. And you see, automatically, when we continue to pray, you see the revival happens. Because reformation prepares the way for revival. And revival is the result of the restoration of church that spurs the mission, that gives a way for church to grow. So pursuing this personal revival, when we focus ourselves, is a heart pursuing an intimacy with God, is a heart thirsting for more of God. Or are we compromising in any area? When we search and look into our heart, just like how the psalmist searched his heart and he prayed asking God, God, create in me a clean heart that it may be pleasing to you. We also see in the revivals, Charles Finney says revival as this. Revival is the coming of the inexpressible, sweet, and tender Spirit of God into the midst of His people with convicting and transforming power. The outpouring of God's Spirit is the divine aspect of revival, while the preparation of the heart is our part. When we do our part, you see God do His part by pouring out the Spirit. We need to ask God, create in us a clean heart that we may pray, we may seek more of you in us. When we have this as our prayer, you see God do great and mighty things to revive us and also set us as a spark to birth a revival in and through us. As we seek ourselves, setting our heart right unto God. What pleases God is a humble heart. Only an humble heart can submit to God, can surrender to God completely. Revival usually happens when we repent. Repent is not something, you repent of what you did, of the very act that you committed. It's not that. Repent means something that, you're turning your whole life and saying, Lord, I displease my life that I lived in. Here I want to live according to your will. This is a complete surrender. It's a U-turn. Saying, Lord, I don't want to live a life. I don't want to lead a life that was away from you. Here there's a complete surrender, complete dependence on God. A humble heart is willing to accept the responsibility of wrongdoing. Every failure, every wrongdoing, you're willing to come in front of God and repent and ask God, God, help me to overcome. And a humble heart is one that surrenders and yields to God's instruction and God's will. So we see that a humble heart is one that is utterly dependent on God. It has no confidence on itself. It has there's no credit that it takes on its skills or talents, but it gives all glory unto God. So we need to come to a place where completely surrendering, Lord, I surrender myself into you. because I want to be one with you. I want to abide in you and you in me so that I can be fruitful in your kingdom. Because any work in God's kingdom cannot be done by man or by man's ability alone, because it's supernatural. We need God into our life. We need God. We need to partner with God to get the God's work done. We see in 1 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 4 states like this: if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. So it is not something that you and I can do, but then it is God. When we call upon God, upon his name, and humble ourselves by surrendering ourselves completely to him, repent and ask God, God, forgive my sin, forgive us in the sins of us, our family, our city, our nation. When there's an earnest cry raised up to God, you see God who hears our cry, forgives our sins, and he heals our land. When he heals our land, he makes it whole. He makes it fruitful. It like how initially it was intended to be. God's plan will be fulfilled in and through us, because his plan is to prosper us and give us a success. So in Hosea chapter 10 verse 12 says, sow for yourself righteousness, reap in mercy, break up your fallow ground. For it is time to seek the Lord till he comes and rains righteousness on you. So what is that? Fallow ground is the land that once which was used to cultivate. But now it has been abandoned, left uncultivated. Now God is asking, call so that this land that was rejected, this land that has been abandoned, we can plow it, we can clean it, and rework on it. So how do we rework on it? By praying, worship, seeking God, getting ourselves cleansed, seeking for purity and pursuing it. And when we sow in righteousness, you see, we will reap the fruits of mercy. That's what this verse says. Lord will help us to sow in righteousness that we may reap his mercy. And also in the same chapter, when you see in Hosea, in the same book, Hosea chapter 7, verse 1 to 7, but especially verse 4 to 7, verse 4 says, I will heal their backsliding. No matter where we are, no matter how far we would have gone away from God, but when we desire for more of God with the earnest heart of seeking God, you see, God is promising us that he will heal us and restore us back. God's healing for the backsliding. He will revive us. He will once again make us fruitful. And you will see the hand of God upon our life. God is looking at a heart that is earnestly hungry for God, because God can respond to that hunger, to that heart that is thirsting more of him. You know, our God is a God who keeps his promise. He's a promise keeper. Because in Matthew chapter 5, verse 6, one of the Beatitudes, he says that blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. I repeat, blessed are those who are hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Look at the promise that God is giving each of us today. As he's saying, revival, I'm talking to you. I'm talking to each individual. Revive yourself. Set things right. Do not look at others, because set your eye on me, because I look at you. I call each individual, you're precious, you're beautiful. I've called you by your name. I've set you aside. I've sanctified you. I've purified you. You are a vessel of honor. I've called you by my name. I chose you. And your God is saying that when you hunger and thirst for more of God and more of his kingdom, he will fulfill, because he is a God, his promise keeper. When God fills, he fills it abundantly. A heart that is hunger knows how much he needs to be filled. And when God pours out the Spirit, he will pour out the Spirit at the cost of the hunger that each one have within you. So we need to hunger for more of God, just like how David knew this. He desired for more of God. When we read about David, you see that he was never content of knowing God. He always had this quench within him for, more of God within him. He always hungered. He always thirsted for more of God. He always had a check within himself saying, Lord, check my heart and set it right. He always said, like, Lord, it is better for me to be in your court than to be anywhere else. He's a king. He had all the liberty. He had the luxury to do what he wants to do. But here he chose to be in the presence of God. Psalm 63:1-2 says, O God, you are my God. Early will I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you in a dry and thirsty land where there is no water. So I have looked for you in the sanctuary to see your power and your glory. So Psalm is a person like, have said, David is a man after my own heart. How did God say this to David? There were so many other people. There were many prophets and kings, many men of God. But God looked at David and he said, he's a man after my own heart, because he had captured the essence of God. He had known the nature of God and he carried the nature of God within himself, yearning for more of God. Yearning for more of God, despite the times, in his good times and in his bad times, he seeked and thirsted for more of God within him. David sought the Lord earnestly and intently all the days of his life. All the days. Even in Psalms 27 verse 4, it says, one thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, behold the beauty of the Lord, and inquire in his temple. This is the desire. Now, David is not saying something for the sake of writing a song. No, it's his heart's desire. You know, we cannot pretend friend of God, isn't it? God looks at the heart. He's not a God who looks at our words, but then he looks at our heart attitude. This was the earnest desire that David had to seek God all his heart. And here God is looking for people who are passionate and persistent after him. We also see in the book of James chapter 5 verse 16 to 18. James chapter 5 verse 16 to 18. Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth produced its fruits. So you see, Elijah, being a man like you and me, demonstrates the power of God through his prayer. How? Because through his life, he had an intimate relationship with God. He persisted God. Even in his prayer, you see, he has a passionate, heartfelt, and a persistent prayer. Till he see the result, he never gave up. We also are very familiar with the story of what happened at Mount Carmel as Elijah prayed for rain. It was God who expressed his will that he was going to send rain on the earth. Because it was God who expressed his will, Elijah just didn't stop saying, okay, God has expressed it, he will do it, why should I pray? No. Elijah prayed because Elijah knew when a man in his natural sense, he prays, God responds. God responds. The same way when you and I are a bit natural, but when we go with this intense, passionate, persistent prayer, God responds because he's the same God. The same God who was with David, who was with Elijah, is the same God with us. When we get onto our knees and pray persistently, you see the Lord will move. He's a God who hears every cry, every whisper. He's much closer than our breath. When we get onto our knees and pray, you see, Lord hears our prayer. And this is what happens in revival. When we pray, God moves. We also see in the New Testament book, Gospel of Luke, chapter 18, verse 1 to 8. Gospel of Luke, chapter 18, verse 1 to 8. We see that the Lord Jesus taught us to pray consistently without giving up. He says we must have this heart that remains consistent in its request. Unwilling, we should come to a place like, Lord, I'm not ready to give up. I'm not ready to stop. I want to see my prayer being answered. So God desires to answer people's prayer when we are consistent. Just like how in the Old Testament, we see Jacob did not give up. He knew it was an angel. No way he could compare himself with angel. No way he can fight with the strength of, you know, supernatural strength. But then he never gave up. Because he never gave up, he was persistent in saying that until and unless God bless me, I will not let go. You know, because of his very nature of receiving this blessing, you see, God changed his very name from Jacob to Israel. As he wept and sought for the favor of God, we should also do it. In the book of Hosea 12:4, he says, like how Jacob engaged with God that night, physically, there's no match. Human comparing with the angel who has a supernatural strength, no way. Same way, when we have this persistent prayer, we cannot compare ourselves with God. But then when we pray, it's God who desires, when you pray, I will answer. When you pray God kind of prayer, I will answer. Now, how do we know how to pray God kind of prayer? Romans 8:26-28, when we read, he's saying, like, I will pray in and through you. The Spirit himself will groan in and through us. It will raise prayer that will please God. It will raise prayer that is as per the will of God, for God's plan, God's purpose to be fulfilled in and through us. So all we need to do is partner with God in prayer. When we have this heart for the people of God, for the city of God, for the nation of God, we will travail in prayer. We will align ourselves to the plan of God. We will align ourselves to the purpose of God. See, when we align ourselves to the plan and purpose of God, everything changes. Our heart attitude changes. It becomes more compassion towards people, whereas as a natural man, it would not be. A natural man's heart will look out for vengeance for people's mistake. But here God says in Matthew 14:14, when you see, whenever God looked at people, he moved with compassion. And whenever word in the gospel, when you read, whenever Jesus moved with compassion, you see it landed up, or it ended up when seeing miracles, signs, wonders happened there. So even today, when we pray on behalf of everyone, you see our heart changes, our heart moves in compassion of God. So what is very important? Your prayer. Because prayer is the key to revival. Prayer is the key to bring change among people. Prayer is the key to bring heaven down on this earth. So what we need to restore back is the prayer, a prayer life that is pleasing God. So some of the points that has been listed in our notes for us to heal the Holy Spirit when we are focused on leading a time of prayer. There are certain points that may be helpful as we prepare ourselves to revive us, to be that spark of revival in our city and nation. 6 points, I'll just read out a few points and you can make a note. And as we make a note, it's not something that we need to make a note in our book and Bible to remember, but this is something that we need to apply within ourselves and say, Lord, help this attitude to be in my heart that I may revive myself. The very first point is prayer for repentance. All these points are there in your notes. We are on page 117. Page 117. It says, first point, prayer of repentance. Very important. We need to consecrate ourselves. We need to heal ourselves by surrendering ourselves to the plan of God, asking, Lord, I repent. I reject the life that I led before. And here, I want to lead my life that is pleasing to you. Consecrate it. Point 2 talks about prayer for more of God and a great outpouring of the Spirit. Pray for more of God and for a great outpouring of the Spirit. So we need to express our hunger and a longing for more of God because we desire to know and experience God more than ever before. We should come to a place like we are not content with how much God has revealed to us. So as you know, it is one of the promises in Acts chapter 2 verse 17 where God has promised to pour out His Spirit and all during the last days. When He says all, on all flesh, everyone. There's no age. God didn't say, I'm going to pour out Spirit only on the pastors, the leaders and ministry people. But then He says on everyone, including your children. And in Zechariah chapter 10, verse 1, He says that He has told us to ask for rain in time of latter rain. So when we pray and ask, you see God pour out the Spirit even in the time when it is not. So God to pour out the Spirit in an increasing measure, more of the latter rain. The third point here we see is prayer for the manifestation of the glory and power of God. Prayer for the manifestation of glory and the power of God. We see that God desires for His house to be filled with His glory. Because it's God's desire. He wants to see His people filled with His glory. So this should be our prayer saying, Lord, may we see God's glory on us, upon each one of us, upon your people. Just as the disciples prayed in Acts chapter 4, we also should pray and ask God to do signs and wonders in and through us because that's the expression of God's glory. And fourth point is prayer for the salvation of the lost. This should be our thirst as well. We need to cry out to God for the Holy Spirit to move powerfully in and through us among the community of people. So when we pray and ask, when we minister, we see that the people are convicted of their sin. Come to the knowledge of the saving grace of God. Come to the knowledge of Christ that Jesus died on the cross and they receive Him as the Lord and Savior. So that the lost souls can be saved. This is one of the key points in our revival. When we pray, yes, signs, wonders, miracles, all that is part of it. But most important and the greatest miracle that we need to consider is one receiving Jesus as the Lord and Savior. Because in this very moment, heaven rejoices because a soul has been added to the kingdom of God. Point 5, we see that prayer for the transformation of the community. We need to pray for God's kingdom to be released in the community. In the way Isaiah describes it in Isaiah 26, chapter 26, verse 9, he says, with my soul I have desired you in the night. yes, by my spirit within me, I will seek you early. For when your judgments are in the earth, the inhabitants of the world will learn righteousness. So we need to pray and ask God, because it is God's will that the city, the church, the community transforms. When we say transform, there's a true repentance from the heart. Revival brought transformation in the city, in the community. There was a true discipline. They had the fear of God in them. So what is most required in the revival is the fear of God. When we have fear of God, you see, lives have been transformed. Lives have been transformed. Community has been transformed. Last one, the sixth point is exercise kingdom authority and dominion. Exercise kingdom authority and dominion. Matthew 16, chapter 16, verse 18 and 19 says, "And I also say to you that you are Peter. On this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." So what is Jesus telling? The church has been vested with kingdom authority on this earth. So we need to declare this, because God himself has given us the authority. Whatever I bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever I lose on earth will be loosed on heaven. Because God has given us the keys of the kingdom of heaven. So we need to declare so that we can advance the kingdom of God in our community. We need to declare against the darkness, against the people who are, you know, objecting from the king, from the enhancing the kingdom of God. And we need to call people and do this God's marvelous light. So how do we do it? In Matthew chapter 9, verse 14 and 15, we see that the Lord Jesus said that one of the practices of the friends of the bridegroom, when the bridegroom is away, is that they will fast in that period. They will fast in that period. So here we see that we are called to fast and pray. Earnestly seek God. God, may thy kingdom come and thy will be done on this earth. So one of the books that we would like to suggest you for this fasting and pray, where we can travail in our spirit and pray, is, make a note of this book name, Shaping History Through Prayer and Fasting by Derek Prince. I repeat it. Shaping History Through Prayer and Fasting by Derek Prince, where it highlights on these three points following the prayer and fasting, where it says, the first point says, fasting intensifies prayer. Fasting intensifies prayer. The second point talks about fasting brings deliverance and victory. Fasting brings deliverance and victory. Third point says, fasting prepares for God's latter day. Fasting prepares for God's latter rain. So there is an importance for fasting and praying. When we fast and pray, forget our focus in place. We intend to seek God. So the promise of the latter rain in the book of Joel, chapter 2, verse 23, is the outpouring of the Spirit. This is what he says in chapter 2, verse 28, that, you know, I will pour out my Spirit upon people. And 29, it talks about consecrate a fast, call a sacred assembly, gather the elders and all the inhabitants of the land into the house of God, Lord your God, and cry out to the Lord. We also see in, so we need to get into this search of God. We need to get into this, a place where we search God with prayer and fasting, because God has already promised a great outpouring and many more blessings when we do it. So how do we get into it? We need to engage and pursue more of God in our life, so that we can see God's power work in and through us. We should be a people who will not give up, but then who will partner with God with this intimate love. Because in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 4, verse 9 to 12, it teaches us two are better than one. So what is it we are going to say? That two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him up. Again, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one be warm alone? Though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him. And the third fold cord is not quickly broken. So what it means here is God is asking us to call upon people. Don't just pray for a revival alone, but look out for the like-minded people. When there are many people, there is power. There's power when everyone raise with one voice and pray for God's revival to take place. Okay, so we need to create this environment. Before we could create an environment, we need to create our heart condition. Set it right so that our prayer, our heart attitude will be a sweet smelling aroma unto God. And God, who listens to our prayer, will answer it. Okay, so with that, we will end the session with a word of prayer. Dear God, I lift up each one of us, Lord, into your hand. Lord, as we seek you with all our heart, all our mind, we pray that you will revive us, Lord. Revive us, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father, for setting our heart right, just like how the psalmist looked up to you and cried out, Lord, create in me a clean heart. Create in me a clean heart, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray that each of us here in our class, oh Father, we pray that create in us a clean heart, Lord Jesus, that we may look up to you. Lord, I pray that you are a God who looks at each of our heart, Lord. Our heart is front of you. Our heart attitude is front of you. Lord, I pray that you clean our heart. Uproot everything that does not belong to you and your kingdom. Yes, Lord Jesus, set our heart right. Pour out your spirit upon us, Lord Jesus. Renew our heart and pour out your spirit so that our heart may be right front of you. That may please you, O Father. That it may bring a revival within us, that may revive us and bring a spark of revival in the place where we are. The prayer that we are praying for our church, our community, Lord. I pray that you will change us to be that person, to be that person who are carrier of your presence, carrier of your revival, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray that you will create in our heart that where our heart yearns and thirsts for more of you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Let this be our prayer, Lord. Let us not be content in the place where we are, but then help us to seek you and more of your Father. Lord, as we pray in all our weaknesses, I pray that you will reign, oh Father. Lord, I pray that you will give us this earnest desire, just like the psalmist, Lord, where we can wake up early and seek you, oh Lord. Seek your face alone, oh Father. Knowing that you are a God, God all-powerful, God almighty, Lord. Thank you for more of you in us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for joining today's session. God bless. See you all next class. God bless. Hopefully next class should be our last class. Thank you. God bless. We are completing our portions. Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you so much, my pastor. Thank you so much, man.
Thank you, you know. Thank you. Good. And so next class, I will also give a assignment. We will have enough of time to complete the assignment. Yeah. Thank you. God bless.